Good morning, HFA. Welcome to church. I hope you guys are excited to be here this morning. We're excited to have you. First-time guests, thanks for joining us this morning. Just to mention, if you are a first-time guest and did not receive a connection card, make sure you pick one up on the way out so that we can make sure that we can connect with you sometime this week. We're not going to call you 50 times or whatnot. We just want to touch base with you and build that connection and just say thank you for coming and just get to know you a little bit. Go ahead and stand to your feet. Those of us that were here last night, you might be a little sluggish since eating 12 different kinds of desserts, but I hope that you're excited to be here and we can bring the energy and give the praise and glory to Jesus this morning. Amen? Amen.
You live, you die, you rise. Hallelujah, louder than sing a little louder.
Oh, sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Oh, sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Hey, sing a little louder.
in your presence, Lord. Lord, as we gather today, we just stand before you, God. Lord, we offer our greatest praise and honor to you, Lord Jesus. God, you're the one that's worthy. You're worthy, Lord. We're so thankful, God, that we have the opportunity to even stand before you, God. That we can raise our hands, lift our hands to you and say, thank you, Jesus. That we can also say, Lord, we just want to praise and honor you, Lord, with the best that we have today, Jesus. The one who's seated on the throne. We just lift up your name, Jesus. And we just honor you. God, I'm just so grateful, Lord. We love you, Lord Jesus. Oh, Holy Spirit of God, just have your way in our lives and our hearts. Lord, as we just lift up those individuals, God, today. Lord, for the Brookman family, Lord, for the loss of a precious lady, Lord, who spent years even serving in this church, Lord. Lord, continue to be with Dave, Lord, as he takes this new journey, Lord. God, with the loss of his wife, Lord, Father. Also for my friend Doreen, God. Lord, I just pray right now that you would put your hands of protection around her, God, and keep her safe, Lord. Father, for the Messick family, Lord, continue to bring healing into their bodies. God, for the one that is discouraged today, Lord. Father, you're right there with them, God. You're walking right through it. Jesus, right now, would you just take your hands of love, arms of love, and just wrap it around each individual, God, that is here today. Lord, that needs to hear that whisper. God, that one that's walking through that dry valley, God. Lord, the one that, Father, feels lonely, God. Just fill up their loneliness, Lord, with your peace and your joy. God, we thank you. We honor you, Lord. Now, Lord, prepare our hearts and our minds for your word. Lord, prepare us to receive what it is you're trying to say. Build us up, Lord, today. Make us warriors for you, God, soldiers in your army, Lord, that we can go forth and proclaim your name to the nations. Let us be that sending church, God, that we have people not leaving here in discouragement, Lord, but leaving here encouraged today. Speaking your name to that lost individual that they encounter. Lord, let us be a church that is built of believers who want to be sent. Lord, even right now, just here we are. Anoint us, Jesus, as we proclaim your words today, Jesus. We honor you. And we thank you, Lord, for all that you're going to accomplish today. It's in your matchless and wonderful and most precious name we pray. Everyone said, amen. You may be seated. As you're being seated, look around. Say hello, good morning to someone you may not know. There's a lot of individuals that are coming in that for the very first time, it's good to have you here this morning. When you came in, you should have received a guest card. If you did not, and maybe you've been coming here for 6 or 8 months and you've never filled one out, I would encourage you to do so. It's just a great way to connect with you. We send out cards, and that's how I give information to Miss Leah, to send out cards, also phone calls and text messages. It's just a great way to connect as a church. And that's really what we're trying to accomplish, is make sure that you know that we're not forgetting about you. Amen? Because there's no way that I can remember everyone's phone number. Now, I've got probably 90% of your phone numbers, but I don't have 100%, amen? But that's how we connect. We're just excited about being in God's house today. How many are with me, amen? I don't know about you, but I said it again, but God is so faithful. You know, I've had a week that's been busy, and, you know, there's trying times, but God is so good. When I get into this message, I want to share a story in just a couple minutes about God's faithfulness. Even in my own life and things that I've seen take place. And you know, you know, God's going to use this today, and I just want you to be a hearer of His Word. So I titled my message, Blind Truth, and behind me, you know, we'll have a couple pictures in a minute, and in a moment, we'll go over those pictures. You've probably seen many of them, but have you ever looked at something that doesn't really look like what you think it is, or you view it in a differently than what it is? You know, maybe it's jaded, or maybe it's a mirage, or, you know, an optical illusion. Sometimes people can take 3D computers and make animated art that it's really odd and just really abstract. You know, pictures taken at the right moment that look like something that they are not. Now, I was in the concrete industry for many years, and Rick can attest to this. He's been out on jobs before where these guys will pour this concrete. If you know anything about concrete, there's one ingredient in concrete that comes out of it, and that's water. So you can imagine looking across this flat surface of a big pad like this one in this building, and you would see this puddle of water. And, you know, this pad would be perfectly flat, but yet there'd be this puddle of water, and it would look like the puddle was 3 or 4 inches deep. But in reality, it was just a little skim of water. Just the optical illusion of that is just amazing how that works. And then once the water evaporated, that hole would be gone. It's just strange things. But behind me, you can see these pictures as Sharon pulls up the first one. You know, some of you see a different picture there. How many see a rabbit in there? How many of you see a duck? Right? Sometimes you can see both. Some people see one. Some people, you know, that art. How about the next slide where this is a really old picture. I remember this from when I was a kid, and that's pretty old. But, you know, you can see the elderly lady, and if you look really closely, how many of you can see the young lady? She's facing away. A lot of us remember that picture from when we were kids. How about the next slide? This is a pretty cool one. The Tour de France. Anybody know what that is? It's a bicycle race through Europe, and it's actually in France, and it's pretty competitive. A lot of money goes in. But one thing I never noticed in this picture until I looked at it real closely, how many of you see the bicycle up there? The R is shaped. Sharon, you can hit the next slide. See it there? Isn't that wild how they put that in there? Here's the next one. The next one's Hershey. How many love Hershey chocolate? How many of you ever went to Hershey just to eat the chocolate, right? We went up there 1 year for Christmas. I said, I'm never going back there for Christmas. Pennsylvanians like the going out on Christmas. And it was really cold, but we like to go there. I love Hershey Kisses. My wife tries to keep them hidden because I like them a little too much. But how many of you see something really cool in that picture? I didn't see this until I actually read up on it, studied up on it, flipped to the next one. There's a Hershey Kiss right there. Isn't that cool? You wouldn't even know that. I had another picture I didn't put up there, but it was a picture of this beautiful landscape. And you could just see, it just looked like these flowing mountains and this lake. It was a picture of a mud puddle. But it looked like, from the close up, it looked like a landscape, but it really wasn't. So this week, we're going to explore John 9. As we've been walking through John, it's the story of Jesus healing a blind man. He and his disciples had been traveling, and they come up on this man who has been blind since birth. And many of you have probably read this story. Now, I had to dig deep in this passage because there's a lot. It's a large amount of passage here. So I'm going to try to chop through it pretty quickly for you, just not to bore you all day. But I want to get God's, you know, what he's saying to us in this word. You know, many times, and we're going to talk about this today, we miss the big picture. You know, we miss what is actually going on, or we miss, you know, in those pictures, we miss those little things that are going on, like in the word Pinterest. You know, if you've ever seen that logo, the actual P has got the end of it as a pin. You know, things like that, I don't recognize and don't see those things. And it's just odd to me when I find those, and I find them really cool. But I'm going to start in verse 1, so if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to John 9. I'm reading out of the New King James. I use NIV, I use several. I don't just use one, but I like this one. It just helps me better. But it starts in verse 1. I'm going to go through, I believe, 7 or 8. I think it's 7. It says, "Now as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, saying, 'Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?' Jesus answered, 'Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world.' And when he had said these things, he spat or spit on the ground, and he made clay with the saliva, and he anointed the eyes of the man with the clay, and he said to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is translated sent. So he went and washed, and he came back seeing. Let's pray. Lord, we're just so thankful that we can read your word. We're thankful, Father, that your words were anointed long before we ever opened up a book. Lord, we thank you for your Holy Spirit giving guidance and wisdom to these men and women who penned all of this great text that we go through, God, that reveals your truths into us. God, we are so grateful that we have them, God, to discover who you are, Lord. And we thank you, God, that you would just anoint my lips, Lord, anoint our ears, that we hear exactly, God, what you are saying to us. And Lord, if we're the one that is, you know, struggling through something, God, help us to chew through it, God, and to see your truths on the other side, God. And for that, we want to honor you, and we thank you, Jesus, for being here with us in our midst. In your name, amen. So the disciples had this tradition of thinking that, you know, the same thing that many Jews struggled with. They thought it was because of, you know, when people had an affliction or a disease or they had great loss or something happened, that it was caused because they had sin in their life. How many of you know that was a teaching, you know, by the Jews back in that day? And I think some of them even today may still believe that. This thinking came from their teachings. They would have been taught, of obviously, from the Torah and also the Talmud. The Torah, which was the written law, was handed down by Moses. And we, you know, when we read the New Old Testament, we go through the first five books of the Bible, we read what Moses penned there. These books compiled by Moses, of course. The Talmud is a Jewish writing that refers back to the Torah. It means, it's other words, it's an oral explanation of what the Torah is actually saying. And according to Jewish tradition, this is something that these Jewish people, would have been taught from. You know, it was pretty pivotal in their education realm. You know, they would talk about their ethics, their culture, their roots. And it is a It was a compiled from several many years of people putting it together, giving kind of like an idea of what they thought the Torah was trying to say to them. You know, they had this preconception here, the Jews, that this man was a sinner and he was being punished. They're saying, you know, he's being punished because he has sinned. You know, when you read in the Talmud, it gives an example of when someone was stricken with leprosy, this was the reason why. So it explains it right in there. If you have leprosy, here's why. Here's the effects. You were either gossiping, you either murdered, you lied about something, you were involved in some forbidden sexual relationship, you were arrogant, or you were a thief, or you had a lot of envy going on. These disciples connected that with this man's blindness, you know, to sin, because they asked the question, who sinned? That's the question that they asked. We know from reading the book of Job, how many of you have ever done a study of the book of Job? We did that in young adults several years ago, and I learned a lot about Job's friends. I don't know if I would put quotations around that or not, because his friends beat him up pretty good. They thought he had sinned. They're like, you know, you've sinned, obviously, and I even have a passage up, you know, to show that. But, you know, they were accusing him, they were saying, you know, you've got something going on. I mean, all you need to do is just ask God to forgive you, Job. But as we know, when we read that story, we know that's not the case. We have the luxury of that, do we not? We have the book of Job to read and understand. So Jesus addresses his disciples' shortcomings by saying this. Neither this man, thank you, Pastor, neither this man nor his parents have sinned. That's what he says here. He says neither one of them have sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. Excuse me. The disciples seemed more interested in debating it. The question of why this man was blind or who had sinned, was it him or was it his parents? Because in their minds, you know, if it wasn't this man that had sinned, obviously his parents had failed, right? That's what they're talking about here. Their theological understanding came from this interpretation of this oral law that had been handed down from them, and they suffered from the teachings of this human knowledge of what God was trying to convey. And, you know, they tried to use this understanding from what they were taught, which is, you know, they didn't really understand the purpose potentially. They understood what they had learned this teaching, but as you know, when you learn about the Pharisees and the scribes, a lot of times they had their own written laws that no one could ever abide to. Amen. I know I couldn't do it. Jesus knew what was about to occur. It's pretty cool how he already knew. He would turn a dismal situation into a triumphal healing of this man who was blind from birth. I don't know about you, but that's where I would be like, this is awesome. You know, God healed me from something that I had from birth. That'd be really mind-blowing, really. His central truth of this entire passage is summed up with his declaration that the purpose was to reveal the works of God in this man's situation. That's the whole central truth of this whole book, is he's saying, through this, I'm going to show who God is. God's going to reveal himself through this. Now, this is where I struggle. Are you with me? I'm just telling you, I struggle with this. Sometimes situations happen, I wonder, what's going on here? You know, why is this taking place? And one of my illustrations is Melinda Miller, and I know Ryan is here. That was his mom. And Melinda worked here at our church, and Pastor Jeff, myself, and Bonnie, we worked with her literally every day. And so we walked with her through this, and I knew more about cancer than I needed to know, right? Because she gave me a life lesson on how it works and, you know, all these injections, and she had a port right here, and we would talk about these things. And she said to me one day something that never left me. She said, Trevor, I don't know what God is doing, but I know he's doing something. I don't know why I'm going through this. And she even gave her testimony. You can actually go back on our website and watch it. The women's ministry had an event here one night, and Melinda got up and gave her testimony. How many remember that? Some of you ladies here. It was powerful. She was not just talking about what she heard. She was talking about what she was living. She was walking through this dismal time in her life. You know, she would come in, and even up to her last moments, we would have conversations. And she said, this is not fun, and this is not what I expected. This is not what I anticipated. But I know God is doing something in the midst of all of it. In human understanding, this man's destiny was lifelong blindness. That was it. That was all he had to look forward to. How many would want to look forward to that every day? And somehow he had been, you know, maybe involved in some kind of sinful activity or corruption even by his parents. That's what the people around him thought. They're like, well, this guy's obviously been mixed up in sin. That's why he's like that. Or maybe, you know, the people would walk past him and say, oh, he's that way just because his parents were failures. They sinned. You know, Jesus is trying to attempt to get them to identify a different viewpoint or vantage point in this situation. What is God up to? What's he up to here? What is he, you know, is that really what God is up to? Now, I'm not here to tell you that I think, you know, God makes bad things happen just so he can prove himself. I think what he's doing is he takes situations that are bad and he proves himself through those situations. I could tell you stories, and I'll just give you another one. I can remember a time when when my mom and dad were on their way to Harrisonburg. This has been about 4 years ago. Most of you remember it. And they were coming. They both had the flu. So they had to come to Harrisonburg to come to the doctor. And on their way, a lady ran across the center line, ran off the road on the opposite side of the road, and hit them head on. And we remember the car was totally, it was totaled, and my mother got broken up really bad. She had literally, I'm not kidding, every extremity was broken. Arms, legs, wrists, ankles, hips, knees, it was just broken. And she was we went over to visit her in the hospital that day. Pastor Jeff and myself and Roger rode over, and it was not looking good. Amen. And Brad Huddleston came in the room with me, and we began to pray over my mom. True story. Brad Huddleston was here. He would tell you it's true. We start praying. My mom's arm is broken right here. You ever had a broken arm? How many of you can lift your arm when it's broken right here? So she's in a coma. We start praying. Brad starts praying. Her hand starts lifting off the bed. True story. It was something I'd never seen in my life. And after Brad got done praying, she laid her hand back down. Now, she was in a coma. And I thought, God, what is happening in the midst of this tragic event? That you know, what is going on here? I mean, I was like, I couldn't understand why this was happening. God, they've served you their whole lives. Even though they have things going on and they mess up just like the rest of us, what are you doing? And I started praying. I said, God, you know, I just want you to help my parents through this situation. Lord, whatever it is you're trying to do, Lord, make it come to pass. Well, the prayer that I prayed, and one of the things that I asked for was, I said, God, I want you to do this for my parents. Can I tell you that today, the exact prayer that I prayed, God has taken care of? Now, my mom does walk around with a walker, and she doesn't get around as well as she did, but I've seen something transform in our family. The dynamic in our family has transformed some. It has changed all. I'm still working on my little sister to go to church, but my older sister is in church every Sunday. And I'm looking forward to the day when I can say all of my family is in church, and I'm still praying for them. You know, in this miracle, Jesus initiates the action here. He first chooses an unusual way to perform this miracle or this healing. He spits on the ground or into the dust, and he makes a mud pie, and he rubs it in the man's eyes, and he tells him, go dip in this pond. Go dip, you know, in this pool. Now, how many of you want me to go outside? If you want to try it out, if you're having eyesight problems, can we go out and get some dirt and try that and see what happens? What would your eye doctor tell you? That's insane, right? The other day I was cleaning up my house, and my wife, I was being the good little husband, and I was cleaning with too much bleach. At least she thought it was too much. I thought it was plenty. I couldn't smell anything. Lost my smell from all the bleach. But I hit the side of the bathtub that I had, and it went right in my eye right there. Immediately started burning, so I flushed my eye for like 20 minutes. And I went to the doctor. She said, yep, you burned your eye, so you have to take these eye drops. And then I lost them, and I was like Jerry Painter, where's my eye drops? But I found them, and I went back on Thursday, and she said, yeah, it's healing up really good. You don't have anything to worry about. It's going to be fine. Was it some extraordinary Holy Spirit saliva that was coming? Perhaps it was the same dirt that God formed Adam out of, amen? Or was it some water that was saved over from the Garden of Eden? You know, what the disciples and the others saw as a godly curse became the origin of God's power in action. His power was being in action in that moment. This man was receiving sight. It was the man's faith that initiated this. Jesus said, go, you know, he gave him the ability to see because he said, he did what Jesus asked him to do. Do we not struggle sometimes with that? He said, go wash in this pool. So the man did it. What does it say? It says, so he went and washed, and he came back, and he could see. He was seeing. That's what the scripture says. You know, is that sometimes the view that we have when we evaluate our lives? What is God attempting to do, even when I don't understand? Even when I can't even conceive what he's doing? For me, it is giving up control and letting God work. That's the difficult part. Because I like to be in control. I mean, I know some of your personalities here, right? I was putting chairs last night. I heard some of you yelling, get those chairs, right? And I'm, some of the girls are laughing. But thank you, by the way, for all your help. But sometimes we like to be in control of all situations, do we not? Let me just tell you this. Sometimes we have to accept that that is the plan. And to make the best of each circumstance, no matter where we are. Because I know I know many times I've walked through some situations. I'm like, God, why am I going through this? Why? One night I remember coming to my wife and saying, Trina, why am I going through this? Why is it such a struggle? And she said, I'll never forget when Trina said this to me. She said, if you're always on the mountaintop, you're never going to know what it's like to get to that point. You're going to take it for granted because sometimes you have to go through that low place to be able to go up that mountain, even though it's a hard climb, and get to the top and realize what God is doing and how faithful he is, even in the toughest circumstances. If I'm not careful, I sometimes can get an attitude of bitterness or blame towards God. I've been there. When my son had his accident many years ago when he was 14, and he had his trachea rip, and you've heard me talk about it many times, I was mad. I was literally mad at God. I was like, God, this is a kid that's never really been in trouble. He's always been a good kid. And many of the teachers in here who had him in Sunday school and had him, you know, all the years, you can't find a better human being than Tanner. He's such a, why is this happening to him? And for 1 year, I walked around dragging that ball around hooked to my leg going, why? But here's what the amazing thing was, and this is a testimony of God's goodness. In the midst of him being locked down for 6 to 8 months in his room, and literally the kid, I think a couple times I think Pastor Jeff picked him up in his convertible and took him for a drive, and Chris came and picked him up several times and took him for a drive. He had a trachea tube in. He couldn't do anything. The kid became an incredible piano player. Literally sit down and learn how to play piano. And to God's glory, to this day, even in Mexico, he goes to church, and guess what he's doing? He's playing a musical instrument unto the Lord. And I've listened to him many times sit down at that piano or on the guitar, and God has done a work in his life. He's a missionary. He's a teacher. He's an education. God is continuously using him. And I just thank the Lord for those type of situations. You know, I need to consider that maybe God is working out details for a purpose, even in a tough situation, and that is hard to understand. Jesus used this grim situation to bring light, freedom from bondage, and to demonstrate God's authority over our human struggles. This man can now see. He can physically see, and he is seeing for the very first time. Can you imagine that being the very first time you've ever seen? I remember watching a video a few weeks ago of this little baby who couldn't hear. And somehow they had done like one of those cochlear implants. Have you ever seen one of those? And this little baby, for the very first time, they turned it on, the battery. This little baby could hear noises. And the facial expressions of this child just lit up the room that she could hear for the very first time. It's amazing to me. I can only imagine what he was walking through. He couldn't make that up. You cannot make this story up. It's a real story that took place. Again, Jesus says here, and I'm going to reiterate, it says, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Now, Jesus proclaims, you know, his light. He uses the metaphor light and also day to share how he will, you know, he'll be able to work. It's daytime. I can work. How many of you have been a farmer, or you work out in the fields, and when it's daytime, you can see to plow? And yes, I know a lot of farmers cut at night because of their tractors, but primarily they work mostly during the day, and they use daylight as their way to see. They're working. He said, because a time will come when that will be gone and you no longer can work. Here's a fundamental truth there. Jesus is challenging them to see the value in the time that they have in front of them. We as Christians miss that so many times. I had someone tell me this the other day. I just wish I would have started serving Jesus at a younger age. All the years I've missed, I think it was Bill, actually. I think it was in the class. Bill was like, there was a couple years where I went through a transition in my life. I wasn't really following the Lord. And he said, my friend over here was staying plugged in. Was it Doc Brown? What was his name? Dr. Brown? Michael Brown, I believe. Is it Michael Brown? Who is a really educated Christian man who has a lot of good theology. And I know I see Bill post some of his stuff from time to time, or see things that Bill has tagged. But it was just sharing that I wish I would have stayed the course a little closer. You know, sometimes I believe that's me. Do we really pay attention to that? Or are we just so busy, you know, chopping through life that we forget that God's in the midst of all of this? Because everything that we have, everything that we know, will be gone someday. Everything that I work for is going to be consumed someday. It's either going to rust to pieces, fall apart, be burned, whatever. It's going to be gone. As the church, do we recognize that? That we have daytime to work. That's when we work. It's a representation of our life. Do we use it to accomplish God's will? Is that, you know, is that what we realize? Or you know, do we know that we are an instrument to accomplish his purpose? He wants to work through you. How many of you love when you know God has used you in a way that you don't even sometimes understand? And I just look over this whole chapel, and I can sit back and point out individuals that I know that God has used you even in the simplest things, and sometimes you don't even realize it because you're not really getting consumed by the things and the affairs of the world. You're just staying the course. You know, one of the things that, for me personally, that has helped me is just being consistent. Just consistently staying in God's Word and consistently. I've never been the best at anything, okay? Just telling you that. I've never been the greatest. I've never been the best speaker. I've never been the smartest guy. I've never been the fastest. I've never been any of those things. But I just stayed consistent and faithful. Consistent and faithful. Faithful, faithful, as we heard a gentleman speak several years ago. Jesus said during the Sermon on the Mount, you are the light of the world. He placed that upon us. We're now the light of the world. How many want to be a light of the world? How many we want to shine before men? Amen? When God starts to do a work in our lives, minor or significant, small or even enormous, we need to understand that he can use the strangest means and sometimes, you know, difficult things to display himself. Even in some strange ways, and you're like, well, what do you mean? Like for me, I've always used things like to accomplish, you know, to reaching students. I've always tried things like, you know, I'll go play basketball with them on Friday nights, even though they run circles around me, right? I'll play on the softball team because I'm the guy that when I came to church here for the first time, how I met Jesus on a deeper way is because I kept coming to play softball. That's a true story. People were like, you mean that's why you came? Yeah. I'm not going to lie, Pastor, no offense. I mean, I know you're a handsome guy and you were a great preacher, but I love that softball team. And Greg Hansborough, where's Greg? He's here somewhere. He's in Children's Church. Greg was one of those guys that was in left center and I was in left field, and I'd start becoming my heathen self, and he'd be like, oh, Trevor, it's going to be okay, brother. Let's pray. You know, he was that guy, because I'm out there having a meltdown because somebody slid into third base, and I thought they slid a little too hard. True. We have people here today that can give testimonies and stories of times when something challenging took place and yet God seemed to move in those situations. I know I sit down with people who tell me, I just get excited when people do that. How many of you, Pastor Jeff and I, over the years had the opportunity to go out and visit? And I remember Brenda Wood. How many remember Brenda Wood? I would go see Brenda Wood and I would leave more blessed than I ever, she just blessed me. I'd go see Diane Fink's mom. This lady was literally laying in her bed. She couldn't move. And before I left, I feel lifted up today because I went to see her mom. She was just a blessing. How many of you want to be that? Right? Do we not want to be that? Even in a tough, dire situation. And not all of these situations are about healings and about, you know, sicknesses and healings. Sometimes we don't receive the healing that we expect. Sometimes we go through situations and you know, people pass on to the next life. I'm envious. Can I say that? When I know that they're serving Jesus, they are where I want to be someday. Amen? I want to go there too. I'm going to hurry along here because my notes are long and I know you guys are tired of me talking. It said, therefore, the neighbors and those in verse 8, and those who previously had seen that he was blind said, is not this he who sat and begged? Some said, this is he. Others said, he is like him. He said, I am he. Therefore, they said to him, how were your eyes opened? He answered and said, a man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. So I went and washed. I received sight. Then they said to him, where is he? He said, I don't know. In one miraculous moment, Jesus fulfilled what God promised in Isaiah. God's salvation would come and it would bring change. And you can read it in Isaiah 35. His neighbors are now inquiring about Jesus. Did you hear what I said? They started asking about Jesus because when you are presenting Jesus in yourself and when you start talking about the goodness of God, trust me, there will be people that will inquire. I want to know more about this Jesus. I want to know, why are you so happy all the time? Why are you the guy that even in tough situations, you call upon this Jesus guy? You call upon him because I know who holds my future. I know who's got me in the palm of their hands. And I know that someday I'm going to get to walk up to him for the very first time and thank him for all he's done in my life. That's the Jesus that I talk about. When John the Baptist was in prison, Jesus spoke that same theme. You know, John the Baptist would soon be beheaded. And Jesus said, go tell John that these things which you have heard and seen, that the blind see and the lame walk, and the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. He said, that's what's taking place, and John's going to be encouraged because he was pretty discouraged in that moment of his life. Your story is more valuable than you think. I love hearing them. I love hearing the goodness of God from people. It builds me up, amen? Verse 13, they brought him who formerly was blind to the Pharisees. Now it was a Sabbath when Jesus made the clay and opened up his eyes. Then the Pharisees also asked him again how he would receive his sight. He said to them, he put clay on my eyes and I washed and I see. Therefore, some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God because he does not keep the Sabbath. Others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? And there was a division among them. They said to the blind man again, what do you say about him because he opened up your eyes? He said, he is a prophet. He is a prophet. Here's my weakness. I'm like the Pharisees. I want to be in control. I may be too busy. I have things going on to understand what God is doing. I get into a comfort zone. Sometimes I fall prey to things that, you know, I'm just stuck on them, right? We can't do it that way. You know, I can't do it that way, God. That's just different than what I've ever learned. It violates who I am. I can't do that. Jesus is violating the Sabbath, and the Pharisees are losing their minds. They are half out of their mind upset because it has been ingrained in their DNA that that's just a law you have to follow. Even though it was one of those laws that they had combed through it and kind of came up with their own little plan. Their Sabbath law had to be kept without any doubt. One of the Sabbath laws that you couldn't spit on the ground because if you did that on the Sabbath, it was like working. They considered that work. Jesus did both. He healed on the Sabbath and he spit on the ground and he rubbed it in someone's eyes. So he's breaking all kinds of their laws. Being supportive of the Sabbath is not a bad thing. Can we say amen? You know, the only flawed part here would be how this institution of rules and regulations seemed more critical than the restoring of this man, which was God's will. See, that was where it got in the way. It wasn't that what they were doing was a terrible thing, but they made the law so heavy, and it was like, how many of you can sometimes not do things on Sunday, right? What we would consider our Sabbath, right? Sometimes, you know, when my wife comes in, the dishes need washed, and she might do that. Or you know, something happens where, you know, we have to work on Sunday, whatever. I'm not supporting that. I'm just saying that sometimes it happens. The key is that, you know, here that some believe, even if the unbelief of some of the Pharisees, who were their spiritual leaders, they were following them. They had a curtain of rules blocking the miraculous. They were so busy, they couldn't see past it. Talk about couldn't see the forest for the trees. Of what this man was experiencing. And just to fill you in on a little secret, anytime God goes against our human reasoning, we get uncomfortable and we want to resist. That's one of the first things we want to do. Whether we are a follower of Jesus or not, that's just how we're made. The opposition will happen in people's hearts and minds. We don't like it when it's not according to our plan. Anybody ever had your plans changed and you don't like it? Just me, right? Some of you raised your hands. The rest of you we're going to pray for. The Pharisees were blind by laws, positions, and traditions. The Pharisees, as they debated, this man was proclaiming Jesus as a prophet. As they were getting upset, this man was rejoicing. Let me read further, 18. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and received his sight until they called the parents of him who had received his sight, and they asked them, saying, is this your son whom you say was born blind? How then does he now see? So his parents go through this dialogue with him and says, hey, you know, because out of fear, they knew that they would be kicked out of the temple if they would have agreed with what he was saying. So they kind of just said, you just ask him. He's old enough to fend for himself. Ask him. But he was blind. He is our son. And he was blind from birth. And so they called him again and they started questioning him again. What happened here? The Jewish leaders didn't believe he was blind and had been healed by Jesus. They called, you know, his parents, and they questioned him. The debate was in chaos. Just think of the chaos that was going on. And yet the man continued to confess. One thing is for sure. I was blind and now I see. I was blind and now I see. The blind truth is that the man who had no vision could now see. And not only could he see, he could see everything. And there's more to the story. The second time they called him in verse 20 here and through 26 through 29, and they told him the same story. And he said, I was blind.
I was the guy. It was me. I was the beggar. I was the blind guy. But now I can see. Skipping over to 30, says, the man answered and said to them, Why? This is a marvelous thing. What you do not know where he is from, yet he has opened my eyes. Now we know that God does not hear sinners. But if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, he hears him. Since the world began, it has been unheard of that anyone opened the eyes of one who was born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered and said to him, you were completely born in sins. Are you teaching us? And they cast him out. This healed man, you know, he says this about their unbelief here. Not about the miracle that Jesus performed, but the unbelief and the blindness became apparent to him. That this, you know, he was the blind guy, but in reality, they were the ones that were blind. He could see, but they couldn't see. Even though he was talking about physical, but it was also their spiritual blindness that he was talking about. He becomes the teacher, the lecturer in that moment. Not only his physical eyes were open, but his spiritual eyes were no longer blind. Of course, he goes on to say, God doesn't listen to sinners, and you know, meaning one who has no initiative or any kind of, you know, seeking God at all. You know, that's what I'm not talking about us. We all sin, fall short of the glory of God. I'm talking about someone who just turns their back on God completely. He said, if this man is a sinner, he gave me sight. If he's a sinner, he gave me sight. And that contradicts what God is all about. That's what he's saying here. If he was not from God, he couldn't do anything. But he is from God, as my worship team or praise team, whoever's coming up. His words express that Jesus came from God. And I'm going to read my last passage here. In verse 35, it says, Jesus heard that they had cast him out and went and he found him. And he said to him, do you believe in the Son of God? He answered him and said, who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him? And Jesus said to him, you have both seen him, and it is he you who is talking with you. Then he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. And Jesus said, for judgment I have come into the world, that those who do not see may see, and that those who see may be blind. Then some of the Pharisees who were with him heard these words and said to him, are we blind also? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no sin, because now you say, we see, therefore your sin remains. Can we say amen? This man was healed. He got persecuted for receiving a miraculous miracle in his life. Then he got rewarded with a revelation that Jesus said, I am he. I'm the Son of God. Then the man worships him. He says, I believe. He earlier called Jesus, he called him Jesus earlier by name. Then he called him a prophet. Then he labeled him a man of God. And now he sees him as the true Son of God. This transformation took place in just that one story. We are all spiritually blind from birth. That's what when we go through John 9, gives us a picture of how Jesus heals blind souls. We're all spiritually blind from birth. Jesus takes the initiative in healing us from that blindness. Jesus does not work, does a work of creation in us. He does it inside of us. He calls us to be obedient to what he commands us to do. You know, just like the man, he said, go dip. We become a mystery to our former associates. People don't see us the same. They don't even see the same person. How many of you here can say, I'm that person? When God transformed me, he rocked my world. He took me from all the stuff that I was, junk that I was once consumed by, and he helped me fend it off piece by piece. He peeled away the onion. He broke it off. And for me, that's been a process. It's been a journey. We display loyalty to Jesus when we're persecuted. We testify of his works, even in the midst of that. Paul talks about that. We pass from having no knowledge, being blind, to having excellent knowledge.
brings us to a more incredible worship to God. Because I can say, God, where you've brought me from to where you've brought me to, it's because of you, Jesus, that I'm here. In this story, we really don't get a big picture of what this guy's name is. It doesn't go into a lot of detail in John 9. But he wasn't interested in that. He wanted people to know about Jesus. He wanted people to know him. The one who sees and understands that we're all sinners, saved by his grace. Amen? When we have the attitude that we have no sin, we're blind. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what the Romans proclaims. But also, what is God up to? Some of you that are walking through maybe a valley, a place right now, what is God up to? You may not see it, but I would just encourage you to continue to pray. Continue to honor the Lord even in the middle of it. I would have my wife come up and give her testimony, but there's absolutely no way she'll do that. But one of the things I saw take place, and I've told you this story before, I saw take place in Trina's life, is when we went through this situation, I saw her faith, boom, explode. It encouraged me. She's the one that keeps me on the right track. And I mean, Jesus does, but my wife always encourages me. I catch her praying. At night, when it's dark in her room, I'll feel my wife go. And I know what she's doing. She's praying. What a testimony to me. Do we see the blind truth in all this? When I was going through this verse, through this chapter, God was just beating me up. Not in a bad way. It's not what I mean. It was like, Trevor, you got to see me in these things. Even though I've messed up, even though you've messed up, Trevor, in the midst of all of it, I've got things going on that you're not even aware of. So just keep doing what you're doing. Jerry Painter said, Trevor, you're hard on yourself. You know, God's still moving, and it's true. So let's just bow our heads for a few moments before we take up Holy Communion. Josh and Katie are going to come and lead us in that time. I want to ask you a question this morning. How many of us here today can say, I'm walking through this tough situation, and I don't know what God's doing? And I just need God to help me. If that's you, I just want you to say, that's me today. Hands are going up all over. We don't understand. Sometimes we don't understand, but just keep seeking his face. Keep seeking the Lord. I just believe that the Holy Spirit is even right now beginning to give you comfort. As even as we're talking, Jesus is right there with you walking through that valley. God, I would pray that each individual, Lord, that raised their hand and the ones that didn't, God, you would continue to just be by their side. Lord, even when we don't understand, God, what you're up to, God, that we continue to put our trust and faith in you, Lord, and you walk with us. Lord, just help us carry that heavy burden, Lord, that we sometimes do. Father, we just honor you, Lord, in those moments. Maybe you're here today and you would say, you know, Pastor Trevor, I don't know Jesus. I got things going on. I'm a mess. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to invite you up here. Here's what I want you to do. You don't even need to raise your hand. Here's what I want you to do. God is standing right in front of you. Jesus is right in front of you, and here's what he's saying. Call on my name. Call on my name. Young person, if you're here and you're not sure, just call on his name.
Just begin to say, Jesus, heal me. Heal my broken heart. Bring peace into my life. Forgive me of all of my sins. I've made mistakes. And when we do that, He forgives us, church. It's that simple. Lord, we thank You, God, for Your salvation. We thank You for Your word. We thank You for healing. We thank You for restoration. We thank You for walking with us in our times of despair. We thank You for giving us the peace and the joy to be able to honor You even when we're walking down a tough road. We thank you for giving us the time that we have to speak Your name boldly. We thank You, Lord, for putting people in front of us that we can be a mouthpiece for You, Jesus. We can be Your hands and feet. And we just honor You, Lord, with all that's said and done this week. Go with us, Lord, and keep us safe in Your protective arms, in Your name. Amen. Katie and Josh, oh, they're already here. Thank you.
Church, as we respond to the message, as we gather as the people of God, we, on the first Sunday of the month, we take communion together. Something the church has done for thousands of years as they've gathered to proclaim this God that has transformed them as they have gone through this process that the blind man went through. And now we proclaim with them what Christ has done in us. If you have not yet been served, if you need the elements of communion, we have some ushers in the back. You just want to slip your hand up. They'd be happy to come and drop them off to you. I would encourage you to go ahead and get started opening them. Because sometimes, you know, it's just one of those things. But we'll be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. My wife has her Believer's Bible up here. It's marked tremendously. So with my eyesight, I got no chance at reading that. So I might try some mud when we get outside. It sounds like it's coming. Paul writes to the church at Corinth, a church that was much like ours. They gathered together in all of their humility, if you will, and all of their difficulties. And Paul writes this to them, reminding them of the Passover meal that Jesus had with his disciples. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. He had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" This morning, we remember the Lord's death with gratitude, with hearts of thankfulness for what the Lord has done in and through us, for the ways in which He has transformed us, and for the ways in which He has brought us along the journey. So let's pause a moment in meditation and reflection to give thanks to the Lord for things in our lives from this past week, from this past season. As we look back and see the way in which the Lord has been with us.
As we remember what Jesus has done, and as Josh read this passage, the whole reason that Paul takes time to teach the church in Corinth how to do this is because they're doing it wrong. So glad that they were doing it wrong so that we can know how to do it right. How can we can remember God's sacrifice correctly, with correct hearts and minds and lives devoted to Him. So the reason that Paul writes this is because there are divisions in the church in Corinth. This is why we get this instruction. You can read about it in the greater part of chapter 11. But Paul writes this because there are divisions in the church, and he's saying you're missing the point. You're coming and you're taking communion on your own, and you're just doing it on your own, and that's not what I intended. I intended you to be a community. I intended you to have common good, to seek the benefit of others. And when we remember Jesus doing this in the Gospels, we remember that Jesus also washed the disciples' feet. And he said, serve one another like I have served you. And so as we remember Jesus' death that was for us, it wasn't just for us individually, yes, but also for us collectively, that as we partake of communion, as we remember what Jesus has done, we also remember Jesus' words where he says that we have to die to ourselves and live for God. We have to die to our own interests and look to the interests of one another. And if we live like this, our needs are met by God and by one another. So we're going to take a moment and we're going to say, God, where has there been division in relationships in my life? Where have I not been seeking the interest of others? And so let's just take a moment and be honest before the Lord and then receive the Lord's forgiveness. It's already been offered to us. So as you ask the Lord to help you see, where has there been division? Where have I been selfish and not seeking the interests of the common good of this church community and the community around us? Then receive God's forgiveness. So take a moment for that this morning.
Just missed getting out on time. If you would grab the bread, hold it before the Lord. And again, Paul writes, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Church, let's take the bread together.
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. You can hold your cups up to the Lord in remembrance. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. We thank you, Jesus, for your blood that was poured out, for this new covenant, that it is a covenant for all people, that together, collectively, we have this covenant with you. And you are always faithful. Help us to also be faithful. Let's take the cup together.
Paul concludes the passage for saying, whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So gracious God, we pray that we would proclaim your death until you come. God, we know that on that day, some 2,000 years ago, that the world was changed because of your sacrifice. The world was changed as you brought heaven to earth so that we may live the kingdom in our lives now. And so, God, may we proclaim like this blind man did in our passage this morning. May we tell of the goodness of our God. May we share it amongst our friends. And may we proclaim it to ourselves as we go throughout our weeks, as we go throughout this community that desperately needs the story of redemption. Heal our bodies, heal our world, and use us to do it, King Jesus. Come quickly. And all God's people said, amen and amen.
Amen.
Now to continue our time of community as we've taken communion, we'll now continue with the announcements as what we can do as a family together. Go Dukes.
God is faithful, amen? He's good. Well, if you didn't pick up a bulletin when you came in, you can take one home or you can just go to our website. Everything that's in the bulletin is on our website. Just a few things that we're going to be doing here in the next few weeks. Next Saturday, we're having a yard sale here, and if you'd like to participate, the information is on our website. There is we charge $20 a spot, but you can come, pay, and then you can have one spot. And how many tables are we saying?
Two
tables, and they don't cost additional for those two tables. And we're going to have the parking lot full of people and kids and yard sale items, and we need everybody to come out and buy all the junk I don't want, right? Please tell the community so they can come buy the stuff I'm getting rid of. That's just coming Saturday.
We've had a lot of first-time visitors over the past few weeks, so we took the time to put in here the announcement about Girls Club that meets on Sunday nights at 6 p.m. Linda and Margaret do a great job with that. So if you have kids the ages of 5 through 11 or K through 5, girls, please bring them out. Also, youth, which is 6th grade through 12th grade, they meet Sundays at 6 p.m. and Wednesdays at 7 p.m. So if you have anyone within those age groups that would like to come out, we'd love to have you and build up those ministries.
Also, HFA softball, that's how I got hooked. So we're hoping you sign up and get hooked, amen? But if you'd like to play, you can just register. Trust me, you can outplay me because you can have my position. I will give it up gladly. I say that at every practice. But just looking for some ball players that like to be a part of that, just register on our website. Anybody's eligible. It is male or female. I would just encourage you to talk to Stephen Harper. Where's Stephen at? Yeah, he's right there hiding. He's right behind Dylan and Michaela. But he is our coach, and we just have you go register on our website.
And they do have practice tomorrow at 6 p.m. and Saturday at 4. So if you can make it, come on out so that they can find a place for you on the field.
It's at West Rockingham.
It is at West Rockingham, correct.
Which will be really muddy tomorrow.
Yes. We are doing our vacation Bible school June 15th through June 17th, so we have the registration on for volunteers. We have many, many roles that need to be filled as far as decoration, registration, teaching. There's just a bunch of things that we need filled. It's going to be for 3 days. So I just encourage you to go on and sign up for something, to volunteer for something.
Next Sunday, we will be celebrating Mother's Day, correct? Katie Moran, who's just up helping with the communion, will be speaking. I'm looking forward to that. But our youth group is doing a really neat fundraiser. They're raising money for AvaCare for these mothers. They're giving these bags as a gift. Thank you, Kim Green, for setting that up. But we're just looking forward to, if you'd like to donate to that, you can just go to our website or put it in the offering at any time. $15 per bag.
Something that Pastor Trevor has envisioned for us is a sense of community, and it's something that the staff has embodied. So we are trying our best to get a visitation and a phone outreach team just so that we aren't the only ones that are doing the calls and the visiting. I think people in the church would like to see other people of the church as well. So if you are interested, please use the QR code or go onto the website and sign up to be a part of either one of those teams. We have list of people already that we would like to send out to have visitors. And then we also have a list of people that we would like to receive phone calls for our shut-ins or people who are unable to make it on a weekly basis.
I think that's enough announcements for the day. You're intelligent enough to read what's left. It's a skate night. Just take that home. Register if you'd like to be a part. It is open to everyone. Any age can come. But it'll just be a night of having fun there at the, at Skate. It's called Funkies now. It used to be called Skate Town. But just go and have a wonderful week this week. Look forward to seeing you this coming Sunday. God bless you and have a great week in the Lord.